Crusader Kings 3 is an easy game, so I've been told. Complicated? Perhaps. But difficult? Never. It's the type of game that once you obtain even a middling level of skill, you will be secure in your ability to defeat just about anything it throws at you. Difficulty in any game is an interesting aspect of both design and player perception. What is hard, easy, fulfilling, challenging, brutal, trivial, or any other manner of adjectives has often been boiled down to this simple chart: the difficulty curve. It's certainly a useful heuristic for difficulty in general, but some games get kind of weird. Some games are sandboxes, like, say, Minecraft. Sure, there's survival mode, but Minecraft is more complex than just survival. Some games have a misleading sort of difficulty, like, say, Warframe. The individual moments of action in Warframe can be challenging, but the game is more about builds and efficiency. Difficulty can be anything that makes a player have to think or act with some kind of skill, I would say. It's broad. I've always found that these sorts of difficulty curve graphs map onto games like Elden Ring, since there's basically one gameplay loop going on. You've probably considered that some people are better at some particular skills in some games than others. For example, some people in Elden Ring are good at hitless runs, and some are good at speedruns, and yet others are good at finding builds to one-shot bosses. Some people just enjoy the game and are good at not dying, or even are good at particular bosses, but overall, they're all playing the same sort of challenge. Each of these playstyles is evident in Elden Ring, and their sum total makes up the game's difficulty curve. They essentially correspond to micro and macro abilities, performance, and planning. I bring up this example because I think it's easier for people to understand it. Elden Ring is a game most of us can look at and, without too much of a stretch, come to understand that, yes, this game has several kinds of difficulty. I want to now abruptly pivot the video to Crusader Kings 3. A long time ago, I wrote a video essay about CK3's difficulty, which I was, and still am, quite proud of. That video's main point was that CK3 is neither too easy nor too hard, but that rather doesn't have difficulty per se, as is the sandbox. Looking back, CK3's difficulty is much more nuanced than that, and I want to make this video as something of a counter to my own thesis from back then. Having learned a lot more about game design and having now worked on a couple, as in exactly two, mods for CK3, I'm beginning to understand better what makes the game hard or easy, and it can be boiled down to three sectors of challenge: opacity, struggle, and actualization. I finally found the words to describe exactly what CK3's difficulty is, and now I'm going to write about it and explain it to you so that when you get into a discussion about difficulty one day, you can actually point to something more meaningful than just hard or easy. Truth is, CK3 is a sandbox, but that doesn't mean it lacks challenge, as an inconvenient secondary truth to that truth is that for many people, CK3 is still a strategy game. In my time playing CK3, and it is a lot of time, I've experienced many difficulties and challenges which I've mulled over and analyzed such that I could effectively break down the parts that were difficult and class them into a particular type of difficulty. I haven't actually been strategically challenged by CK3 in a very long time, if I'm being honest, but it has never reduced my enjoyment of the game. This is because CK3, ultimately, is composed of three difficulty curves which all work in different balances and harmonies to create the overall challenge of the game, and I'm going to show you that with this video. Without wasting any more time, I'm going to break down those difficulty types, starting with the first obstacle to any new CK3 player: opacity. What is a wall but a line of sight breaking obstacle? This is opacity. Yeah, it doesn't get much more eloquent than that. Opacity is the part of the game where you just don't understand what's going on. The mechanics are laid out in front of you, and they don't make any sense yet. Or there are mechanics under the hood which are affecting your game without you even knowing. Opacity is actually pretty easy to understand, I believe, but it constitutes the most crushing difficulty in CK3. Sometimes you die, and a succession happens, and you have no idea what the hell made it happen how it did, so you feel frustrated and you go to Reddit to ask for advice, where a lot of better players might actually scratch their heads as well, or just give advice about managing succession. Imagine, if you will, trying to explain how to walk to a baby that does not yet understand what walking really is. This is what it is to explain how to manage succession to a new CK3 player. Succinctly, succession is the process by which power moves from one character to another, and it has many rules associated with it that will govern exactly how it works. You can give advice to a player about managing it, but they might not yet even fully understand what's happening. Why does giving a duchy to my secondborn fix succession? Because it satisfies his partition demand, but what's a partition demand? And thus, we found the opacity. You see, CK3 is a relatively open game. All the information you could ever want is right there in front of you. Exact effects of personalities, exact troop counts, the presence of civil wars and factions looking to undermine you, and even the existence of people who hate you or rivals. CK3 is a game with relatively high player autocracy, to borrow the term from Rosenkreutz, whose video you should watch, by the way. That being said, CK3 also has quite a few opaque mechanics. How do I know exactly how much land each of my sons wants from me? Well, I can check succession and see that one of them wants a whole duchy, but if I give him one, he might then ask for a kingdom. What gives? This isn't a video about CK3 succession, as that could be a whole video on its own, but instead I hope this point shows to you what opacity is. Opacity, as a measure of difficulty, is the first difficulty bar for any new player, and it's an ever-evolving lesson which never really goes away. I'm one of the most hardcore CK3 players out there, and I know the game like the back of my hand. Every once in a while, something I don't understand will happen. You could say that is an example of a challenge of opacity that I am now going through, which I might safely ignore, or which could get me a game over. There's a very interesting mod for CK3 which I personally don't use, but which many in the community do, and that's Obfuscate. This mod's literal entire purpose is to introduce further opacity-oriented difficulty. Remember all that information about stats, opinions, army sizes, and so on? Well, not anymore. Now you'll have to figure that stuff out by either spying or intuiting it and hoping you're right. This mod essentially emulates the feeling of being lost in a world you don't understand for players that no longer feel any opacity from the base game. It's a well-loved mod, so it seems to do quite a good job of that. Although I haven't played it before, so I'm basing my understanding of it off of other people telling me about it. Take that how you will. I don't care much for opacity difficulty personally, because I like to be creative in my CK3 playing. I love to make stories and achieve great things and all that, and we'll talk about those sorts of things later, but I'm actually not quite done with opacity. See, opacity is the scariest of any difficulty type to base your game off of, because the line between intriguing and frustrating is quite fine. Many CK3 players get frustrated by the game because they don't understand what's going on, and I can definitely understand that. CK3 is a network of systems and mechanics that are almost impossible to keep track of, and this frustration is one of the strongest quit moments for any CK3 player. Even for me, when I've played total conversion mods, moments where things have happened which I don't understand have made me want to quit. Of course, the devilish deal of opacity is that uncovering and solving the mechanics is exactly where the fun comes from. When a player makes the connection in their head and finally understands exactly why something happened, it can be one of the most fulfilling parts of the game for sure. When a player graduates from frustration to intrigue to understanding, they have overcome the opacity wall. For some games, that can actually be the end of the difficulty curve, as the game will then progress from balanced fun into mindless fun into boring. This is the moment where most people graduate into the next difficulty curve, struggle. I want to draw the line, though, between struggle gamers and opacity gamers. An opacity gamer derives their joy from understanding the game, but a struggle gamer derives their fun from overcoming the game. I would say that your achievement hunters and your metagamers are found here. Before we move on to struggle difficulty, I want to leave a few notes about opacity and the important takeaways from it. Opacity is where all beginners start, and it's where most people will determine if they like the game or not. The mechanics the player uncovers during this time are the base of everything they will do for the rest of their playtime, and if a player doesn't like those mechanics, nothing can really pull them into the game. Opacity appeals to just about any gamer, but quickly loses its appeal as the mechanics reveal themselves, if those mechanics are not to their liking. It's important to note that it's not that opacity is only fun for newcomers. The Obfuscate mod proves that even experienced players enjoy opacity. For that reason, opacity is a difficulty type which, like all three difficulty types in CK3, is actually ever-present. You see, I wouldn't want you to be misled into believing that this opacity is only a thing for beginners. There's always some of it in CK3, since schemes are secret, and the AI often acts unpredictably, as well as events in the game being randomized. The appeal of opacity is twofold: novelty and anxiety. Anxiety is fun for the new players who enjoy unraveling the game, and novelty is fun for the veterans who want new scenarios to be presented to them. CK3 without any opacity sucks, and that's because this difficulty curve provides the novelty, or in more gamer terms, the RNG. Randomness, or more accurately, perceived randomness, since CK3 isn't as random as it might seem, is critical to the game, and is also why people complain about seeing the same events over and over. When a veteran player complains about the game having the same events over and over, that is the game failing to meet them in the opacity difficulty curve, and them entering boredom. This is the opposite end of the frustrated player who can't figure out what's happening and is overwhelmed by events. This actually ties deeply into my larger thesis, which is the synthesis of three difficulty curves. Opacity is the most present difficulty curve for new players, but is still present in one form or another for all players. It has to work alongside the much more straightforward curve of struggle, which is what I'll be explaining next. For me, the opacity of CK3 as a curve is basically gone. But because the game remains ever novel with its randomness, and because to this day I don't perfectly understand every mechanic, I still find myself having an appropriate level of opacity difficulty. For that reason, you might think I derive more of my difficulty from the struggle curve. Once a game believes its player understands enough about the game, it will present a challenge. And CK3 immediately bucks this trend by, at least at a base level, having no presented challenges really. If you want, you can begin the game as an emperor, and in theory, that is the highest tier of character, so I guess you win. Obviously, this is not the case. The first challenge a struggle difficulty player might face is often the Steam achievements, which are integrated into CK3 as well as being on Steam. A player might look at something like Lingua Franca and decide, I'm going to get that achievement, and now their path along the struggle curve has begun. Lingua Franca is a very difficult achievement, so you'll likely find yourself pulling your hair out trying to complete it if you're a recent Opacity difficulty graduate. On the other end of that, some achievements would be far too easy, like Until Death Do Us Part, which just requires you to get married. That would be boring to go for. So what if we pick a middling achievement, like the Emerald Isle? Starting as an Irish ruler, hold the Kingdom of Ireland. Great. That seems appropriate. The struggle player will now take all that knowledge they accumulated in the Opacity phase, and apply it towards achieving the goal. They know how armies work, they know how marriage alliances work, and they know what succession is. They might get real close to getting the achievement and then suddenly die, have their realm split into three, and get destroyed by Vikings. Well, crap, back to the drawing board. It's time to think about strategies and tactics at this point. I have a problem, my realm splits when I die, how can I solve that? And thus we have the core of the struggle curve. It's a ping pong match of question and answer. Finding answers is the difficulty. This difficulty curve ranges from clueless players that understand the mechanics but not how to apply them, to your metagamers that can stack enough modifiers to get 500 damage crossbows and conquer the map. This is by far the widest difficulty range, with some players finding a balanced curve of something like forming Ireland, and others seeing Lingua Franca as a worthy challenge. There are many players, of course, who think nothing in CK3 is a worthy challenge, hence the people who say the game is not hard. The process of moving from barely understanding succession to never having a bad succession again is facilitated by learning tactics. For example, need to solve succession and you're doing an Ireland playthrough? Your culture has monastic communities, so send those kids to church. This is an example of something an opacity level player that is moving into the struggle phase would be learning. The opacity level player understands that cultures have traditions that contribute to the game. The struggle player begins to use that information. I'm sorry to harp on about the distinction, but it's important to me that you understand it. Either way, let's move away from the achievements. Struggle players don't always just chase achievements. They might also chase more abstract goals, like reforming Hellenism. Hellenism is of course one of the biggest memes in CK3, with many players loving to revive the faith and bring about a new Roman Empire for Zeus and all that. For a player of my level, this is a trivial challenge. But for a struggle tier player, learning how to revive Hellenism can be quite tough. You have to accumulate not just piety, but faith conversion modifiers, and putting together a strategy to obtain those modifiers is certainly quite fun. Once our hypothetical player has found a strategy and executed it such that they've been able to become Hellenic, they've essentially added a new tool to their tool belt, which they may or may not use, but under the hood, there's a whole other plethora of tools they've been both using and honing on their way there. You see, struggle in CK3 is where the player is trying to win, and this is where I want to once again tie into my larger thesis and explain that in reality, a player never graduates to or from the struggle curve. It, like the opacity curve, is also ever-present. A new player's goals might be something as simple as live to play 3 generations without a game over, and before they've even begun to unveil the game's mechanics over in the opacity curve, they're already attempting to overcome a challenge. The struggle difficulty curve is best represented as the player overcoming the game's obstacles, which might be an aggressive AI, or management of vassals, and so on. CK3 is composed of several gameplay loops, but a few to start are vassal management, air management, and macro warfare. That is to say, you don't really fight in CK3, you pit numbers, your army, its quality, and a commander, against another person's numbers, their army, quality, and commander, with a dash of RNG and terrain to influence it. At all times, a player is attempting to overcome the game's obstacles in order to obtain an end goal, and this is actually where the final curve, actualization, comes in. I know, the struggle curve section is short, and that's because it's the most traditionally understood form of difficulty. Yes, struggle difficulty is literally the fight against the game. It's the fight to outpace the AI, not lose to vassal factions, and to have skilled heirs in service of the actualization goal, which to me is the most important goal. Where struggle comes from the game, and opacity comes from novelty and anxiety, actualization comes from within, and it is the beating heart of CK3. I mentioned achievements in the struggle section, and that's because achievements are very similar to actualization, except that they are presented by the game. Challenges presented by the game ultimately fall into the struggle curve explicitly because they are from the game. Actualization, coming from within and all that, is essentially the much deeper question of why you're playing the game. For some people, in fact I'd say many people, there is a joy in overcoming a worthy obstacle. This is the most basic actualization goal. I want to get Lingua Franca because I will be happy to have defeated this challenge. Everything after the word because is an actualization goal. By using the tactics and strategies the player picked up along their journey through the struggle curve, they can make manifest their actualization goals. To simplify it, the axis of difficulty for actualization could be seen as interest, or even better, opportunity. The opportunity to engage in gameplay that feels fulfilling to an individual player is extremely particular, so it ends up feeling more like a dartboard than a gradient. Paradox is throwing darts at the wall and hoping to hit the largest section of the community possible when they implement things which would provide actualization motivations for the player. These are things like decisions or endgame stuff, things like the Make Bactria Kingdom, things like the Become India. There's no achievement with these for the most part, but they're interesting to do for, I guess, no reason besides your own motivation. This is the sandbox section of CK3, and it's truly a vast place. For many people, the best part of an update or DLC is the set of new achievements linked with it, and in this sense we can diagnose a failure to provide ample actualization difficulty. If new achievements come out and nobody wants to put in the effort to get them, then the achievements were not designed in a way to make a player intrinsically motivated to get them, even if the achievement itself could be of a worthy level of challenge. Consider Lingua Franca, which is a damn tough achievement. The funny thing about it is that in terms of the struggle and opacity curves, it's a terrible achievement. It is horribly boring to do what ultimately comes down to a world conquest. Well, a CK3 map conquest, but you take my point. Nonetheless, the actualization motivation to get this achievement has pushed many people to get it anyway, after which they bemoan the boring nature of the achievement. Compare that to some of the achievements in Legends of the Dead, which most people didn't care for. These achievements lack coolness, and this is where actualization becomes really abstract. That which is intrinsically motivating is entirely different depending on the person, so designing around it depends on knowing stuff about your audience. Take the achievement The Faroe Islands. It's not particularly difficult to get, so it becomes boring for most players from a short perspective. It's not very novel since it's just completing a legitimizing legend in a particular culture, so it fails the opacity curve. But what if you're literally an ethnic Egyptian living in Scotland playing CK3? That might, on its own, be enough to motivate you to get the achievement. That being said, the ethnic Egyptian Scottish community probably isn't very big, so it'll only work on a few people. Compare this to something like Blood Eagle. Conquering all of Britannia as a Viking appeals to many people, not necessarily because it's very challenging, although it is more challenging than the Faroe Islands, but it appeals to the actualization curve because Vikings are cool. Many CK3 players absolutely adore Vikings and their history. Sometimes though, a boring actualization goal could be outweighed by its challenge. Consider Last Count First King, which is a surprisingly tough achievement, but which wouldn't have any particular reason to strongly appeal to a ton of players. That achievement is kind of popular because it actually is a bit of a challenge, but I doubt people are getting really excited about the foundation of Portugal. Sorry, Elizabeth Enjoyers, you're just not that famous of a country. I think you can see my point here about how actualization works, and I want to emphasize exactly how broad this can be. Some players just like to make attractive characters or coat of arms in the character designer, and sure, that doesn't appeal to me, but there's a whole CK3 subculture around making coats of arms and sharing character DNA. Some players come in, get 100% of the achievements, then drop the game and come back when new DLC adds new achievements. Some players roleplay, and so on. You get the point. All this is a form of actualization difficulty. So that's CK3's difficulty curves. I'm going to wrap this up by talking about how they all intertwine, and with that you should have a much better idea of what CK3's difficulty curve is like, and why the game is appealing to so many people for so many different reasons. When we take any given player's experience in CK3, we could take a slice out of a moment of gameplay and figure out what they're going through. The curves are very dynamic and sort of form a slider in a way. There may be times where nothing novel is going on, which would imply the opacity graph is boring, but if the game is presenting a strong challenge, and the player is motivated to complete the challenge, then the game is still quite fun, I'd say. Where the game hits its peak will be different for each player, but broadly, CK3, I would say, depends quite strongly on the actualization curve. That's because, quite frankly, CK3's strategy aspects are not very difficult to crack wide open. Meta strategies, whether building tall or stacking men-at-arms buffs, are well known in the community. It's also well known in the community that events get spammed already, so it's not like there's a ton of novelty in CK3 on that basis. Is this a problem? Well, one could say that, but it depends on what you like about CK3. Personally, I love making stories in CK3. I'm a very narrative player, so as I play, I find fun in considering my realm and ruler's mindsets and all that sort of stuff. It's very external to the game. I also find novelty in creating unique situations in the game by conquering regions and appointing random people to rule them, or by making strange new hybrid cultures and all that kind of stuff. CK3 excels as a sandbox game, and for that reason, its best difficulty curve is the actualization curve, at least for me. I'd argue its weakest curve is a struggle curve. Ultimately, the game just isn't that hard. Sorry, new players, don't feel bad. It's not that you're bad at the game, it's that CK3 is a game which is easily solved. Once you learn how to play tall and stack man-at-arms buffs, you will outpace the AI in everything. So to return to the thesis, CK3's difficulty curve is composed of three different curves, each of which will appeal to players differently. In the future, if you're ever thinking about CK3 being too easy or too difficult, I'd encourage you to consider what kind of difficulty you want, maybe even consider what sorts of sectors of the game would cover that difficulty. I think it's universally understood that CK3 is too easy in the struggle curve and lacks novelty in the opacity curve, but man, that actualization curve is great. CK3 is a sandbox playground where creative players achieve all kinds of things, and most of the DLCs have done a great job facilitating that sandbox. One day, I hope Paradox might try and focus on a different curve, because actualization will eventually die out for most players. This game really could use a harsher challenge that's interesting to overcome, but right now, it's just not there. Anyway, if you liked this video, comment below what your favorite kind of difficulty for CK3 is, and consider subscribing and liking. Thank you for your time.